Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. Thank you for listening today. I hope you would also call a friend and tell them, tune in quickly. We're streaming live at nationalprayerchapel.com. That's nationalprayerchapel.com, one word. We're streaming live there with video. You can watch the broadcast as it progresses, or you can just listen to it on your radio or at WAVA FM, or AM rather. You can listen to the broadcast at their webpage, or you can listen to it at nationalprayerchapel.com. Today I'd like to share with you a part of the story of Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan. This book was first published in 1678. The edition that I'm going to share with you today is Crossway Publisher, edited by C.J. Lovick, and I'm reading by their permission because it is a revised edition, so it's copyrighted. But I'm particularly caught today with John Bunyan. This man, as he worked as a tinker, a humble man without much education, a family to take care of, and a tinker goes door to door in a community repairing pots and pans. As they wear out, they get a hole in them, and he would repair that. It's dirty work. It's hard work. It doesn't pay very much. So he was a very poor man. But as he struggled with the scriptures and with the teaching that he was hearing from the Lord, he began to cry out to God. And he became deeply convicted regarding his sin. And finally, the Lord actually spoke to John Bunyan. I want to read the one sentence that the Lord spoke to him. The Lord said, "Wilt thou leave thy sins and go to heaven, or have thy sins and go to hell?" That was the word of the Lord to John Bunyan, and it absolutely transformed his life. Again, he said, "Wilt thou leave thy sins and go to heaven, or have thy sins and go to hell?" Now, after his conversion, he studied the scriptures extensively and then began to teach and preach, even though he was not a licensed pastor. In England, in that day, you had to be licensed as a pastor, and you had to meet certain qualifications. You had to be accepted. He was not accepted in the state church, and he met none of the educational requirements, but he began to preach, and his simple words brought deep conviction to the hearts of the men and women who listened. And as he would repair pots and pans, he would talk with them about the gospel of Jesus, and their hearts would grow convicted. You see, there's a two-step process that we need to look at very carefully, and we will be doing so this week on Pilgrim's Progress. That is the awakening of a man's soul, and then the conviction of a man's soul. The awakening and the conviction are two different things. And then, of course, you have to go to the conversion of that soul. And then you go to the justification of that soul, the sanctification of that soul, and finally the glorification of that soul. That's the whole journey that we speak about on Pilgrim's Progress. The first step, however, is where we want to focus our attention today and probably tomorrow. We want to look at the awakening of a man's soul. What is it that he awakens from? And what is it that he awakens to? Both are necessary. So let me begin to read for you the first chapter of Pilgrim's Progress. As I walked through the wilderness of this world, I came to a certain place where there was a cave, and I lay down in that place to sleep. As I slept, I dreamed a dream, and in this dream I saw a man clothed in rags, standing in a place with his face turned away from his house. He had a book in his hand and a heavy burden upon his back. John Bunyan is identifying the world as a wilderness, as an untamed land, as a place where there are wild animals that will devour you if given the opportunity. This is how he viewed the reality of our world. And he's very much right in terms of Scripture, because the Scripture says the devil is a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And he and his demons constantly are roaming the earth, seeking whom they can devour. You are one of them they want to devour. They want to take you out. And they have many tricks and many, many ways of gaining your attention and dragging you away to consume you. He says, I came to a certain place where there was a cave, where there was a place of safety. I lay down in that place to sleep. And as I slept, I dreamed a dream, and in this dream I saw a man clothed in rags, standing in a place with his face turned away from his own house. So Bunyan begins by describing every person in this world as a man or woman dressed in rags. Now, as we've shared many times on this broadcast, the journey is from the city of destruction to the celestial city. But what is that city of destruction? As I read John Bunyan, he's very clear about what the city of destruction is. The city of destruction is the place where you dwell in sin. The city of destruction is the place where you are deceived and continue to believe that you are safe and secure, even though you are but dressed in rags. Of course, the lie of our modern age is that you are dressed in the robe of Jesus Christ, and it covers all of your sin, and so when God looks at you, he doesn't see you, he sees Jesus, which is simply a clever lie of the devil. Believe me, when God looks at you, he sees you. And if you're dressed in rags, he sees the rags you're dressed in. Now, we're told in the book of Revelation that the white garment is not the righteousness of Christ. Instead, the book of Revelation tells us that the garments of pure white, the linen garments, are the righteous acts of the saints. Now, let's be clear. Bunyan would not teach, and I would not teach, that a man is saved by his own works. We are saved by what Jesus Christ did at the cross, but we're also saved by what Jesus Christ does now from his heavenly throne as he justifies a man. And the word justify, again, means to make righteous. That's the literal meaning of the old English word to justify. It comes from the Greek word dikaiosune, which means to render innocent or to render righteous. In other words, to take through a process And Jesus calls that process denying yourself, taking up your cross, and following Jesus. So let's be clear. The place that is called by John Bunyan the city of destruction, this man who was a Reformed Baptist in belief, calls the city of destruction a place where you choose to dwell in your sin, and that may be very unconscious sin. I'll give you an example. It's very recent. I went to a news source, and there was a headline. It was a headline beneath a photograph of a very beautiful young woman. And the headline is, "Self-proclaimed evangelical fashion model to appear on Brazilian Playboy cover." I was shocked. I clicked on the picture to see how this young person would logically explain her position. And I now quote for you about the issue regarding my religion that came out in the headline saying, "I am an evangelical. This will be the first and only time I will speak about it. I never wanted to link information about my religion and work since they are different areas." So in this young woman's mind, she believes that she can live in the city of destruction, and yet she's going to be saved without ever walking the narrow path. She says about her Facebook page, quoting, "I am evangelical and use my Facebook to tell how much God was and is powerful in my life. And anyway, what's wrong with being a ring girl?" You understand what a ring girl is? It's the young woman in the very skimpy bikini who, between rounds of the violent fight that is going on, the boxing match that's going on, she walks around with a sign with a number on it giving how many rounds have been fought. It's called eye candy for the crowd. She says, "Anyway, what's wrong with being a ring girl? It is very concerning to know what is right and wrong. But in my view, God looks at our heart and our intention." So in her mind, religion is something very personal. She has an emotional relationship with Jesus. She believes that she is saved. She believes that she is born again. But she continues to live in the city of destruction. And Bunyan's position is very simple, that all who remain in the city of destruction when the judgment day comes will be consumed with fire and will be cast into hell. So John Bunyan would say that this young woman, with her supposed righteousness, with her confidence that religion is personal and that it's between she and her God, and God doesn't look at what she does. God looks instead at what the motives of her heart are. And that's a strange position to hold, because obviously she's doing these very ungodly things for a very high sum of money. She's worshiping at the altar of Baal, but claiming to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And so she dwells in the city of destruction. He calls this being dressed in rags, because there are no righteous acts, no white garments to clothe. And he says, this man is standing in a place with his face turned away from his house. In other words, Bunyan is saying this man is beginning to wake up. He's just beginning to wake up. The first sign that a man or woman is beginning to wake up is when they begin to recognize that they're dressed in rags. And they begin to see the inconsistencies of their life. And they don't say things like, "Well, what's wrong with being a ring girl?" I had a young man just yesterday say to me, "Pastor, what's wrong with going to the lounge and smoking a little bong, and what's wrong with dancing a little? It makes you feel good." You know, I'm a young man. I need some beautiful girls to hang out with. I said to him, "Then you'll be lost, because that's a part of the city of destruction. And you will be swept away when all ungodliness is consumed by the fires of judgment. You too will be swept away." So what's wrong with going there? Well, what's wrong with going there is that you are putting yourself in the city of destruction. You are putting yourself in the bait trap for the lion to come roaring at you and to devour you. I said, "Tell me, what will happen when one of those beautiful girls suggests that, why don't we go have a drink? And then why don't you come home with me? Why don't we play?" And so you've hooked up for a one-night stand, and now God's judgment is on you. Now you are confirmed in the city of destruction. Your conscience has been seared. You no longer feel the guilt over what you have done. And you're on the road down. You are on a descending path toward utter darkness. I hear people say to me, "Pastor, what's wrong with being rich?" Well, there's a lot wrong with being rich, and there's nothing wrong with being rich. It depends on what you're rich in. If you're rich in money and poor toward the Lord, you're dressed in rags. If you're rich in money and you're rich in the Lord, then your riches will be used to build the kingdom of God. If those riches are used to create for yourself a wonderful lifestyle, and you have no heart for God, and you have no concern to build his kingdom, then you are a very poor person. And you are dwelling in the city of destruction. So Bunyan is saying that the city of destruction is continuing to live in my sin. And if you want to move toward the celestial city, the first step you will have to take is to wake up to what your sin is. This is very difficult. I recognize that part of why I see very little response to this radio broadcast is because I've been preaching conviction when most of you are sound asleep. And I have to back up and say, "Lord, how do I wake up the city of Washington, D.C.? How do I wake them up, Lord? I can't wake them up. You have to do it, Jesus. Put the words in my mouth that will cause men and women to begin to wake up, to recognize their sin, to recognize the condition of their hearts." Then Bunyan goes on. He talks about this man who has turned his face away from his house. In other words, he's beginning to wake up and he's beginning to recognize that there are things in his life that are simply wrong, and he begins to feel a burden on his back. Do you recognize bitterness as a burden that you carry? Do you recognize lust as a burden that you carry? Do you recognize pride and selfishness as a burden that you bear? His pack on his back, this burden, kept growing because he was reading a certain book. It was the Bible. As he would read this book, he would be more and more awakened to his spiritual condition, and he began to weep and tremble. And not being able to control himself, he cried out in a loud voice, "What shall I do?" Well, you see, I can come and shout from the mountaintop about what you should be doing to get right with God, but if you're sound asleep, I'm just a fly bothering you. So wave me away. You have to wake up. You have to come alive from your slumber and recognize that everything is not right. Now, if you'll just take a moment with me and think, I know that's dangerous, but try. Think with me. What were your actions yesterday? What did you do yesterday? I spoke yesterday with a friend in rather an abrupt manner. And as I reviewed my life from yesterday, I recognized last night that I had spoken in a rather abrupt manner and that I may have offended them. And so this morning, before I could come to this broadcast, I had to contact that friend and say, "Did I offend you? This is what I did. Did I offend you?" Now that friend said back to me, "Oh no, I knew you were simply walking in love. You were concerned. I was not offended at all. I was very grateful. I praise God that this dear friend was not offended by me." Sometimes when I say something, I have rough edges. Some of my friends have told me, "Pastor, you have some rough edges, and Jesus is in the process of grinding them off." Well, I'm very grateful for that, but I still have some rough edges where I can hurt people unintentionally just by the manner of my speech. On one side, I want to be very clear, but on the other, I don't want to be offensive. On one side, I want to speak honestly the Word of God, but on the other, I want to speak that Word of God and that truth of God with love and compassion, not with judgment or hostility, not with pride or prejudice. And so for me, this is an ongoing, constant struggle that I pray through. It's an area where I have to grow up. It's a maturing on my part that I have to go through. I've always been, on one side, a loving person, but on the other, cut right through to the heart and not play games. Well, I don't want to lose either of those, but in the process, I don't want to hurt people. I want to draw you to Jesus. That's why I'm here, to draw you to Jesus. I'm sharing this with you to say it's necessary that we very carefully look at our words and our actions to determine whether we still dwell in the city of destruction. If you're still consumed with television, if you're still consumed with making money, if you're still consumed with clothing and dress and style, if you're still consumed with the car you drive, if you're still consumed with the unholy relationship that you were in as you live with a person you are not married to, then you are dwelling in the city of destruction. And I'm calling you today to wake up. I'm shouting to you as to a sleeping man or woman, wake up. Turn your face against your house. Read the Word of God. begin to understand as you listen to this pastor that the time is very, very short, that judgment is about to fall on America in ways we have never even imagined. Already the judgments of God are being poured out with strange weather patterns, with mass killings, with wars and rumors of wars. All of this, Jesus said, was just the first signs of the birth pangs. It's going to become much worse. Violence is going to fill the whole earth. Already it's filling. It's as though there's a great welling up of wickedness that's flooding out of, like a geyser, out of the heart of the devil. And it's filling the whole earth. I'm saying, wake up. Don't touch that vile stuff. Don't touch that television. Don't touch those professional sports. Turn aside from them. Don't touch all of the things of the world, the love of the world, the boasting of what you have and you do, the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh. Don't touch this stuff. This is the city of destruction. It saddens me to say that even precious men and women who come to the National Prayer Chapel, when I say to them, my brother, my sister, are you walking clean before God? There are some who will say, yes, Pastor, I'm walking clean. I have the victory in Jesus, and their faces aglow with the glory of God. There are others, however, who will say, no, Pastor, I don't know how to get free of my sin. Well, that's an excuse. When someone says, I don't know how to get free of my sin, they're giving an excuse. They're playing victim. It's very clear how to get free of your sin. You simply cut it off. You say, no, I'm finished. It is done. I'm not going there again. It is over. By the blood of Jesus Christ, I cut it off. We have to decide we want to do that. Do you understand? It is your privilege to decide where you will live. And if you choose to live in the city of destruction, God will let you live in the city of destruction. And when the great judgment comes, which is very close at hand, and the decision is made at the great white throne judgment bar of God, when every man living in the dead will be brought before the judgment bar of God, and every man will be assigned his place. Either your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life because you fled the city of destruction and you made your way on that narrow road, or you continued to live in the city of destruction, and now its destruction is your destruction. So please, do you understand what I'm saying to you? Are you living today in the city of destruction? If so, you must wake up, my brother, my sister. You must wake up, or you will die. You must cut off your sins, or you will die. You cannot live in your sin and leave the city of destruction. When you make your way to the narrow path, you have left the sin behind. That's what Bunyan meant by the city of destruction. He meant the city of your wickedness, the city of your sin, the city of your rebellion and disobedience to the living God of heaven. And he's saying, leave, flee. And so he uses the story of this man called Pilgrim or Christian, who's weeping and trembling, not being able to contain himself. He finally cries out in a loud voice, what shall I do? Until you're willing to wake up and with fear and trembling actually look at the sin of your life and recognize that it will destroy you, that you will burn, you will die under the judgment of God if you do not leave your sin. This is what Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress is all about. Now, our phone number here in studio is 877-534-0780. I'd love to talk with someone today who is awake. Are you awake today? Have you begun to see the sin of your life? Have you cut it off? Are you beginning to awaken to an understanding of where you are before the Lord Jesus Christ and what the danger is that you face? If you're beginning to wake up, call me. I'd like to talk with you. 877-534-0780. You're welcome to call right now. On the other hand, if you have already left the city of destruction and you'd like to call and report on your journey toward the celestial city, I would love to hear that as well. Where are you in this journey? And are you making progress? Now, some people are a little confused by, what do I mean, are you making progress? Well, I mean, are you finally out of the city of destruction? Have you left your sin behind? Are you making your way toward that celestial city? And if so, where are you in the journey? What's the process you're going through? What's Jesus speaking to your heart? 877-534-0780. We have time for your calls. I'd like to talk to somebody who is just beginning to wake up. Or if you're asleep, call me. We'll pray together that you can wake up. If you're making excuses for your sin and you're saying, I've tried, I can't leave my sin, I'm held as a captive, then call. I'll pray with you. And you will be set free. That's the glorious news of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. The gospel is not that you can be saved and continue to live in your sin, as this young Brazilian model believes. She's living in the city of destruction. She loves the darkness while she has her little sentimental love relationship with Jesus. But it's a personal deal. It's not a public deal. She doesn't talk about it. She keeps her work and her religion separate. Well, that's just it. She has religion. She doesn't have Jesus, and she doesn't have the Christian faith. She has a false teaching in her heart. So where are you today? Where are you in this journey? Are you awake or are you asleep? I'll continue reading for you. I looked and I saw him open the book and begin to read. And as he read, he wept and he trembled. Not being able to contain himself, he cried out in a loud voice, "What shall I do?" In this condition, he went home and he tried to keep to himself as long as possible so that his wife and children would not see him in distress. But after a short time, his anguish had increased so much that he could not remain silent. So he began to share with his wife and his children what was on his troubled mind. And this is what he told them. I've been very troubled over the last days by a passage of Scripture that says, "You are not your own. You were bought at a price." Now, instantly, you should recognize that that is the first principle of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He redeemed us on the cross. We're no longer our own. We were bought at a price. And I've been saying, Lord, what does that look like? And he's been giving me insight and understanding. But I've been extremely troubled by the slowness of my own heart, the lack of maturity in my own heart. That's troubled me. Let's take a quick call. The phone number again is 877-534-0780. Sophie, welcome.
Hello, Pastor Ray. How are you?
I'm well. What would you like to share?
Well, I would like to share, you are well aware, I have been listening to your broadcast for over a year, and the week of your teachings, the awakening and the conviction, I think that's a pretty good assumption why you haven't got too many calls, because you are so very direct, and you keep us soul searching. And today I was at a funeral with a friend, a dear friend that was her dad. You could tell by the testimony of the people that spoke about him that he was a child of God, and he lived his life with God. And I just wanted to thank you for your broadcast and for you asking all of us the hard questions, because in my heart, I was a little bit jealous that he's already there being held with Jesus. We're still struggling to make sure that we can follow the narrow road.
So, Sophie, okay. Sophie, let me ask you.
Okay.
Is any part of your heart still yet remaining in the city of destruction? Are you still walking in any of your sin, or have you come clean before God?
I feel that I have, with the last month of healing and with your teachings, that I have come clean. And I am so humbled that I feel broken down, and I just want to be a sponge to be a servant and want to be able to allow my prayers to go for my family and for myself, that they also will become clean and be able to join the rest of our family in heaven.
See, Sophie, it is so easy to be comfortable in this life and to somehow slip into areas in our life that we know are not right. And yet, we don't want to really call them sin, because it's what we do to be comfortable. And it's how we comfort our heart. It's how we take care of ourselves. And so I would urge you to get before the Lord and really search to see if any of the ways that you still find to make yourself comfortable are sin against him.
Okay.
And take some paper and pencil and write down if there's any place other than Jesus that you find your comfort that's still a part of the city of destruction.
Okay. Yeah, well, sure. I know that you had asked us about a month ago, mm-hmm. to write on a paper our sins at one of our prayer meetings. And so this was very sobering. And I put down everything that I thought that, you know, was keeping me away from my prayer and from Jesus. And
but now I'm asking you not what keeps you away. I'm asking you to write down what gives you comfort other than Jesus.
Gives me comfort. Okay.
That's really what the issue is now.
Okay.
Let me pray with you, Sophie.
Okay, thank you.
Lord, I lift Sophie up before your throne. And I ask, Lord, that you would carefully with her make certain that there's no area of her heart or life where she still dwells in the city of destruction. I ask, Lord, that you would put her feet solidly and clearly on that narrow path where there is no longer any, how shall I put it? There's no subterfuge. There's no fakery. Everything is clear and clean before you. And Lord, that's how I want to live, and that's how Sophie wants to live. And so, Lord, I ask that as she enters more deeply into this walk with you, that you'd be very clear in uncovering for her, as well as I've asked in my own life, that you would uncover anything that I have made an idol in my heart, anything that causes me to feel comfort apart from you, Jesus. For I know that everything in this world is to be burned. So, Lord, I plead today for your mercy and your grace and your healing power over Sophie, mind, body, and soul. And give her a powerful testimony, Lord, with her family and with her friends. Make her bold, Jesus, by your Spirit. I pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Ray.
God bless you, Sophie. Wonderful to hear from you today.
Yes, yes. And I'll soon hopefully be worshiping with you again.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye now.
So Sophie lives in another state, but she listens via the internet and watches the video at nationalprayerchapel.com. We have many, many people around the world who are doing this. We have many people in Beijing, China, and in other parts of the world who are following this broadcast, and for that we're very, very grateful. And I love to hear from people outside of the Washington metro area. My heart cry is for all people everywhere to repent and turn from their sin that they might be saved. Now let me deal again with you very specifically. Are you still living in the city of destruction? If you know you are, simply call and say, yes, I am. And I'll probably ask you something like, how long do you want to live there? And are you considering moving out? I have one dear brother. I ask that question, and yes, he's considering moving out, but it's taken him quite a period of time. In fact, he moves out, and then he quickly moves back in. He starts the journey, and then gets frightened and runs back to his sin. And so now he's hunkered down in his sin, and I haven't seen or heard from him for quite a while. Is that you? Is that how you're walking? Hunkering down in your sin in the city of destruction, where the fire of hell is going to burn, where God's judgment is going to be poured out. I am just crying out to you today. Wake up. Don't be caught. Walk free in Jesus. Our phone number, 877-534-0780. Be real with me. Are you living in the city of destruction today? Or are you on the journey, on the narrow path toward the celestial city? Which is it? I know many of you do not want to call. You want to just sit back and listen for a while, which tells me that you are still dwelling in the city of destruction. I know if you were not dwelling in the city of destruction, most of you would very quickly want to call and say, no, I'm not in the city of destruction. I am on my way to the celestial city. And I want to say this to those of you who are still in the city of destruction, and you would have a very clear invitation and message for them. That's what this radio broadcast is for. It's not for me, it's for us. It's for Jesus to use for for us to speak to one another about the gospel, the true gospel of Jesus Christ. But I know you have some place to go. You're in a hurry. Don't bother me, Pastor. You're still in the city of destruction. And when are you going to wake up? Fill your minds with parties, social events, sporting events, family gatherings, church gatherings, all kinds of things that you fill your life with that allow you to be comfortable as you continue to live in your sin. You can call yourself a Christian. You're like this Brazilian model that I shared, this young woman. You don't want to mix your religion and your world. You want to keep them separate. As one man said to me, I know how to hang with the world and I know how to hang with God. Well, what he doesn't know is that he dwells in the city of destruction and he will be burned in the end. So where are you in this process? Telephones are wide open. I'm seeing Mark, line one. Hi, Mark. Welcome. What would you like to share?
Well, Pastor, I feel that I don't know. Sorry for wasting your airtime. I know it's valuable. I basically am calling. I know that life is a pilgrimage. For the Christian walk is a pilgrimage. It's not. It's a constant state of rededication and a constant state of constantly making a conscious choice to follow Jesus and to constantly keep your eyes on the prize, which is Christ.
Yes.
And I feel that I am walking the Christian life. I have victories and I have some setbacks occasionally, but for the most part, the Lord has helped me overcome most of my setbacks.
Mark, there's a difference that I want to draw very sharply for you between immaturity, where we're growing up in Jesus, versus just straight out, this is rebellion against God. And you know it's wrong, but you continue to do it because it brings you some kind of pleasure. That's what I'm talking about. When you leave the city of destruction, it's when you leave all known sin behind. Now you're going to spend your whole time on the journey growing up in Jesus.
Amen.
Okay, and I'm still very immature. And you know what? After I get to heaven, I'm going to have some angels tutor me to cause me to be able to grow up.
Amen.
But I'm not going to sin when I'm in heaven. And I'm not going to go back to my sin, hopefully, while I'm on this earth, because if I do, I go back to the city of destruction.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Amen. Yes, sir. I agree. I know that there seems to be a misconception with people with this one-time saved, always saved, no matter what you do stuff.
Yes.
And that's just not scriptural. And I agree with you 100% on that. I just, you know, I'm a man of sometimes high anxiety, and I listen to your show daily as much as I can while I'm working. And because I'm an electrician, so I listen to as much as I can while I'm working. And I just sometimes get anxieties pertaining to the idea of whether or not I am saved, even though I know deep down in my heart that I am, because I know Jesus.
But see,
I know he's touched my life, and I know that he's changed my life, and he's helped me overcome so much already.
But see, Mark, what I'm trying to say to you, though, is... The devil knows Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing Jesus does not save us. It's letting Jesus have total control over my life that saves me. It's taking up my cross and being crucified. And if you get anxiety about whether you're saved or not, you need to be very specific in that area and say, Lord, what is the specific area that I'm feeling anxiety about? Would you uncover that for me? Or is it just a general anxiety? And in that case, you have the right to just lift up your hands to Jesus and say, by the blood of Jesus, I am saved. I am not walking in rebellion against you Satan, get thee behind me.
That's what I do daily, and it works.
Okay, we're right on. Yes.
Praise God.
Because Romans 8 says, there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus.
Praise God.
And that's wonderful news for me, Mark.
Me as well, sir. Me as well. And I pray everybody feels that.
Yes. Good to hear from you. Thank you for calling.
Thank you. You have a great day.
Thanks.
Bye.
We have about 5 minutes left. Our phone number is 877-534-0780. 3 minutes left. Very quick call if you call. But I want to close today by addressing an issue that Mark raised. We need to get really, really clear in our hearts the difference between immaturity, infirmity, and sin. The scriptures say that sin is lawlessness. It is rebellion against God. Immaturity is simply the human condition. Infirmity is simply the human condition. Harmatia is the Greek word that is used for sin. It means missing the mark. That's not a clear enough definition of sin, however, because if I go out to the golf course and I miss the hole, and I don't get a hole in one, or I don't meet par, that's not because I've sinned, that's because I'm infirm, I'm not skilled enough, my motor skills are not adequate in the golf game. So that's not sin. Sin is when I rebel against God, when I hold on to something. So if your anxiety is coming in your life, as it was in Pilgrim's life, because of his sin, then praise God, that's good anxiety. Let it move you to tears before the throne of grace, and let it cause you to repent quickly and to cut that thing off, whatever it is. But if it's simply immaturity, lift your hands to Jesus and praise him, for there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. But my concern is men and women who think they are in Christ, like this Brazilian model, but walk in sin before God. They've been deceived. My name is Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Washington, D.C. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon.
Before the presence of his glory with great joy, with great joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory.